Well, why don't we get going? Thank you all for coming. It's a beautiful day out there, and here you are in here. But we are going to talk about important matters, and Bob Rack is definitely the one to talk to us about water, which is going to be the subject of his talk. Welcome all. I'm Howard Tinberg, president of the Faculty and Professional Staff Senate, which sponsors this event every year. This is a 2017 version of the Jean Grandchamp Lecture, named in honor of our first president, who's sitting right there, Jean Grandchamp. Most definitely. Also, want to give a shout out to the committee that organized this, Deborah St. George, Ron Weisberger, and Jim Corbin. I know Ron couldn't make it, but and Jim, I think, is heading out here, or is he good? Earth Day stuff, I think about it. Sustainability matters he's attending to. But I am pleased that that you were able to make it. I do have a few biographical facts about Bob I want to say, and I'll just let him speak. Bob is a lifelong resident of the city of Fall River. He grew up in the city's south end. He attended Bishop Conley High School. He received a bachelor's degree in biology from the College of Holy Cross in Worcester, Mass., and his master's degree in marine biology from UMass Dartmouth. He worked as a biological aide and research assistant at NOAA's Northeast Maine Fisheries Science Center in Woods Hole, and a whale watch naturalist for the Princess Cruise Lines in Plymouth, Mass. He then worked for 11 and a half years as a laboratory director at the Fall River Regional Wastewater Treatment Facility, followed by a part-time position as a part-time computer instructor at Dominican Academy in Fall River. He began his career at BCC as a part-time coordinator of the Environmental Technology Program in 1996 and was hired to the faculty full-time in 1997. Has it been that long? Wow. Seems like just yesterday. He has worked on numerous grants from the Environmental Protection Agency, the Massachusetts Environmental Trust, Bristol Community College Foundation, and the National Science Foundation. He holds a Massachusetts Grade 7 Wastewater Treatment Operator's License and a Massachusetts Grade 3 Drinking Water Operator License. He enjoys walking and hiking and gardening and snowshoeing and cross-country skiing. This man gets outside, obviously. Unlike some of us who are just reading inside. Today, Bob will speak on the wonders and woes of water, and someone in the humanities must appreciate the alliteration there. Thank you, Bob.
Oh, good afternoon. Everybody hear me okay?
Yes, sir.
With this? Okay, very good. Now, if you notice, there's some buckets that are distributed, and as Howard mentioned, I was a whale watch naturalist, so in case people get queasy over this thing, but actually, the inside those buckets are kits, so that I'm going to be doing some demonstrations, and if you'd like to participate in the demonstrations, you can, everything I'm doing here, you have in those buckets. So you can actually work along with me. Okay, so we're talking about the wonders and woes of water. Now, we look at our planet, the Earth, and we see that, you know, we know that 70% of the surface of the Earth is covered with water. You know, if you remember, Carl Sagan called it the pale blue dot. And if anybody goes online and you can see his speech about the pale blue dot, it's worth listening to. And so, one of the things that we see on the planet is that because it's filled with water, what's the problem? We hear a lot of problems with water. There's water all over the place. But there is one of the things, when we look at our water supply, 97.5% of the water on Earth is seawater. So it's inaccessible for us to drink. If we look at here, of that 2.5% that's left, 2% is stored in the ice caps. Now, if we think about it, the ice caps are melting. And where's that water going? Into the ocean. So it's becoming more salt water. If we look at 0.5% of that is groundwater, and only 0.03% of that is actually in all the rivers, lakes, in the soil, in the atmosphere. So what does that mean when, you know, in relation to actual numbers. The amount of water on Earth, we have 326 million trillion gallons of water. Seems like we have a lot of water here. But of the fresh water that's available, we have 8.15 million trillion gallons. Still seems like a lot, you know, for what we have. But if we look at what's readily available in groundwater and surface water, it's 1.73 million trillion gallons. And so if we take that water and divide it by our current population, that's 233,486 gallons per person on the planet. The only thing is, due to pollution, only about 77,000 gallons per person is actually readily available to people. And if we think of, in the United States, the average person uses 100 gallons of water a day. So there's 36,000 gallons right there in using per person. And so it still seems like, no, there's enough water for everybody. But yet, water distribution is very inequitable as far as how it's spread around the planet. In addition, stable runoff running down in rivers and all, varies quite a bit. And if you think, 1/5 of all the fresh water on Earth flows through the Amazon basin. Now, how many people are living in the Amazon jungles? Not many. So we're having a lot of water there, but there's not many people able to use that water. Now, some of the drinking water problems we have. Currently in the world, 783 million people lack safe drinking water. And from that, 2.5 billion lack proper wastewater treatment. So proper sanitation. That's a third of the world's population has no sanitation. And what does that mean? 3.4 million people die each year from waterborne diseases, which are totally avoidable by current techniques that we have. And of that, 4,000 children die daily. And that's the most are affecting the young children and all with it, because oftentimes you get the disease is dysentery and stuff from amoebas and all, and so you dehydrate very quickly. And if you're dehydrating in an area where you don't have a lot of water to begin with, it doesn't bode well for what you're doing. And so more people die from waterborne diseases than war, terrorism, and weapons of mass destruction combined. Yet, why haven't we dealt with this problem? It's probably one of the major kind of disappointments of the 21st century, that we haven't been able to provide everybody with proper, safe drinking water. So what about water? You know, when we look at some of the, you know, why is water so critical to us? Because just think, what's the one thing that everybody in the whole world, every living thing needs? Water. You know, we have different foods, we have different clothes, we have different customs, everything's different. But water is the one thing that's common to every living thing on the planet. And so, you know, why is it so important to us? If we look at, jumped ahead here. So if we look at these represent the freezing point and the boiling point of these compounds. And if we look at some of the other compounds that are similar to water, they're all, if we look at 0 degrees, they're all gases at 0 degrees. Water is a liquid on the temperatures that are a liquid from solid to liquid on the temperatures, solid to liquid to gas, in the temperatures that we normally live in on Earth. So why is this the case? I'm going to show you some demonstrations about water. And just going to switch here. And if you want to go along, you can go and use the within the box. If you take out your wax paper out of there and a little thing of water, And I want you to put a couple of drops of water, small drops, on there. And so, can you see them up there? Yeah. And it's best when you can see them closely, because there's wax paper that's in there. You don't have a piece of wax paper? Here's a piece of wax paper. Okay, so you want to just put a couple of drops of water, squeeze them out of that bottle. You know, you just take a bottle like that and squeeze a couple of drops. Now, how does the water behave? It's all piled up together. You see it all bunched into almost like a little ball. Now, if you lift your water, lift your wax paper, what do you notice? It's moving, it's sliding along. And what happens when the water comes next to these drops, come next to each other? They combine together. So what does that say about water molecules? They like to attach to each other. Now I want you to take the toothpick that's in there. And now try and break that little bubble apart. Put it in there and... try and break it into little pieces. It's not... doesn't want to come apart. So water likes to stick together. Now, another thing about water is take the toothpick and put it down and just touch the water to the toothpick and then move the toothpick. So what do you notice? That what's happening? What can the water do? It can adhere to other materials, but it doesn't adhere to the wax paper. Now what I want you to do is there's a piece of aluminum foil in your little box, in your little thing, and now pour that little water droplet onto the aluminum foil. If you pour it, either way. If you pour that drop of water onto the aluminum foil, what do you notice about it?
It separates. It spreads
out. Right?
Yes.
It's not that little droplet that we saw with the wax paper.
It was so easy to control with the wax paper.
So that's something that's and you can actually move this, and it kind of the water clings to the metal. So water is, you know, it's a simple compound, but it has interesting characteristics. And all those deal with the chemistry of water. We hear about its H2O. Well, H2O, it's important why it's H2O, and because it's H2O, that's what gives it those specific properties. Because if you're taking chemistry and all, covalent bonding, we have sharing of electrons between hydrogen and oxygen molecule. Now, the interesting thing about the oxygen molecule is that it's said to be strongly electronegative. Now, what that means is that it pulls electrons to it. So when it's sharing electrons are negatively charged, it's pulling those electrons closer to the oxygen atom. And when it does that, if it makes the outer portion of the hydrogen atom more positive, slightly positive, because the electrons are spending more time towards the oxygen atom. And then because the oxygen atom is having more of the electrons closer to it, it creates a slightly negative pole on the other end of the water molecule. So you have what's called a polar covalent compound. It has a positive end and it has a negative end. And so if you take out your, take out this little kit out of here and open it up, you'll see that it's full of little water molecules. And if you look at the water molecules, they'll bind together. And you'll have, they just come right apart. You know, because these forces that hold the water molecules together are called hydrogen bonds. And remember, oxygen, one thing about oxygen, why do we breathe oxygen? Oxygen, because of its electronegativity, oxygen pulls two electrons to it. That's why we breathe oxygen, to grab two electrons at the end of the chain of energy production. And those two so it's just pulling two electrons. Because of the electronegativity of oxygen, it helps pull those electrons through the electron transport chain that's in our bodies that are using to create energy. If we take away the oxygen, like say, you know, you're not breathing oxygen, those electrons don't move through the system and we end up dying because we can't generate the energy that we need. Because each of our cells is producing energy molecules called ATP at the rate of 10 million per second per cell. We have trillions of cells, so just think how much chemical reactions are going on in each of our cells in a time. So these hydrogen bonds hold water molecules together, and that's why they come together. And this hydrogen bonding is what creates many of water's unique characteristics. And so what do you think is some of the, you know, this is a critical thinking period here. What do I think of some of the effects of having water come together like that, being able to come together for life? That water binds together. Here's, water has what's called a cohesive property, and if we have some water, we have water, you know, because it holds itself together, forms shape on here, it allows us to pour the water. And when we pour it, the molecules don't go all over the place, they're held together. And what's happening with those hydrogen bonds as the water's pouring, it's breaking, reforming, breaking, reforming, because water molecules, the bonds between it, the hydrogen bonds are about 1/10 the strength of the bonds holding the actual molecule together. But they're, so they can be broken, but they're also strong enough to hold the water together. So we can transport things with water. How about anybody see something like this? Now remember, at the surface, let me go back there. At the surface of the water, all those water molecules are bunching all together. And so because, lost molecule, because they're all bunched together, it creates almost a membrane at the surface. So this is a water strider. And he's actually evolved so that he can literally walk on water. And the weight is distributed such on each of his legs that the amount of force that's being put on each leg is not enough to break those bonds between the water molecules. So you can see the little dimples where it pushes down on it, but we don't see the... If we look at You know, we think of things. Here I have a paper clip. You know, you put a paper. Can you... Oh, I'm not seeing things here. If I put a paper clip in, oops, sinks right to the bottom. But if I put a paper clip on a certain way, it floats. Even though it's denser than water, it floats because the weight is distributed. I don't know if you can see that. There, it's floating right there. Ah, there it is, not magic. If I shake it, it'll sink because it's just using the using the surface tension is what's that's called. And surface tension allows, right? That's why when you do a belly flop, it hurts because of those water molecules that are held together at the surface. Now, another thing that we, let me just go down here. Remember, we saw that water can bind to things also. And so the combination of the cohesive property of water plus the adhesive property of water causes what's known as capillary action. And if we look at, you know, if you've done, worked in science lab or something, you always measured something in a graduated cylinder by the meniscus that was on here. And if you look, the meniscus is a little concave thing. So what causes that meniscus is that those water molecules here adhere to the glass, and then other water molecules are cohesively attached to them, and they start climbing up. So here's an example, here's a little thing. If you take this small beaker here, and fill it, put about 10 mils of water in it.
Oh, I see a 10. Let's go with that, all right? What is this?
Sorry. Okay, and then I want you to take, there's a little glass tube in your little kit called a capillary tube. And I want you to put that down into the water. And notice where the water is in the tube. Put it down. Is the water rising up in the tube? So the water has gone up the tube. So it's above the level of water in there because the water molecules are climbing up that tube. And because it's a narrow tube, they're going up and further. So what about you have a piece of sponge in your box? Just stick that, drop that sponge in there. And what's happening to the water? It's climbing up into the tube because sponge has a lot of small tubes in it and openings that allow the water to rise up by capillary action. So, how can this be a very important thing for life, living things? Which living things like to have something where they have water has to go up in them?
Plants.
Someone said plants. You know, we had a lot of plants today, you know, when we were looking at it. So if we look at the, if we look at trees, trees have microscopic tubes in them called the xylem and the phloem. The xylem is for water going up, and the phloem is for the sap coming down. And so because they're little microscopic tubes, the water can make it all the way up to the top of a 300-foot tree without a pump. And so if we look at our little water molecules, and they're all attached together, all the way up from the root, all the way up to the top in those tubes. And as anybody heard of the term transpiration, where water leaves plants and goes into the atmosphere. Well, as the water pulls, the molecules pull to leave, they pull up on one molecule, which pulls up on the next molecule, pulls up on the next molecule, and pulls all the way down to the bottom and helps water move up that tree, all the way up the tree. And so, you know, it's amazing, and it's all due, again, to those hydrogen bonds that are critical to the water molecule. Now, another interesting thing that happens is that's unique to water. Most things, when we chill them, they condense and they get smaller in size because the molecules come closer and closer together. They're not moving as fast and they get smaller. Interesting thing about water is that as water keeps doing that, happens, you know, density is mass over volume. So as we have the same mass, but our temperature is causing the volume to decrease, that's causing the density to increase. Until we reach a magic point of 4 degrees centigrade. And after 4 degrees centigrade, what's happening to the density? It's going back down, which is unique thing to water. So why is that happening? It doesn't, most things go up. But with water after 4 degrees, it goes down. And the reason for this is that as water gets colder, it's starting to form the crystal of ice. So remember, we had all these things in liquid water, it's all crunched together. But as it starts to freeze, the water molecules forming their crystal tend to spread out. And again, it's the hydrogen bonds holding them together, but when the water molecules spread out, as in this picture right here, if we have the same mass, but they're spread bigger, we have greater volume, the density decreases. So that's why when you put an ice cube, even though they're both water, the ice cube floats because the crystals are expanded. And just so you know, just don't put a full bottle of water in your freezer, because the strength of water expanding, it expands about 9%, it'll crack the bottle. It can crack rocks. And if anybody remembers Old Man in the Mountain, you know, who disappeared, because over time, from the water getting in and cracking, making the cracks, eventually rocks. And that's one of the major forces of erosion on the planet and weathering, is water freezing and cracking up pieces of rock. Okay, so this is what the water molecules look like. They're spread out, if you took like a little thing like that. Another interesting thing about water is that when water freezes, or when water's frozen at 0 degrees, when we add heat, and if I had enough time, if we had some ice in there and we add heat to it, the water and ice will stay, and I've done this at kids in lab, so they can vouch for anyone who did it, was the water temperature stays at 0 degrees. Even though the ice is melting, the water temperature stays at 0 degrees. And it doesn't rise until all the ice is melted. Only then will the temperature rise from 0 degrees. And it takes about 80 calories of heat per gram. This is called latent heat of fusion. Latent is Greek for hidden. So it's hidden heat. As we add the heat, it's not changing the temperature, because usually when you add the heat to something, the temperature goes up. But in the case of water, it doesn't. So now, when it's liquid, now we see the temperature rising until it gets to 100 degrees, which is the boiling point. And then as long as there's water there and boiling, I'm adding heat, it's still going to stay at 100 degrees until all the water is evaporated. And then the temperature can go up. So when we talk about working with steam, steam is very dangerous because it can be the steam at power plants that they use to turn the turbines and everything, a 500 to 700 degrees centigrade. So if we think of that getting scalded with that, you know, compared to boiling water, that's nothing. You know, or it's tremendous, boiling water is nothing compared to the steam effect. So when it says caution, steam pressure, you know, caution that because you'll vaporize and you get hit with some of this stuff. Now, what happens when I go in the opposite direction? Suppose I go from the gas into the liquid. Remember, there's first law of thermodynamics is that energy is neither created nor destroyed. So where's that energy going? You know, I put it into the water molecules to turn them into steam. So when I turn them back into water by the process of condensation, where's that energy going? Into the environment, into the atmosphere. And this is what powers hurricanes. Because hurricanes, where do hurricanes form? Around the equator, where the water is very hot, very warm, and there's a lot of moisture in the atmosphere. And so it gets more warm, moist air rises. So it's rising up, and as air rises, there's less pressure pushing down on it, so it expands. And when gases expand, they cool. Cool air cannot hold as much moisture as warm air can, so condensation occurs. It's like when you take a bottle out of your refrigerator and you have it sitting on the counter in the summertime. What happens?
Water.
Say it sweats. Well, what's happening is the water that's in the atmosphere is condensing on that bottle because it's cold right on the edge of the bottle, right on the surface, and the air right there can't hold as much moisture, so it comes out. It comes from gas to liquid. And so we need a surface to condense. So in order for condensation to occur, we need a surface. So just think, anytime a cloud forms, we need a surface for it to form on. But you think, there's no surfaces up there, you know, that's floating around. There's a tremendous number of surfaces up there for, you know, per, over the ocean, a cubic centimeter, that's a little square about that big, has about 150 particles in it. Over land, we have about 350 particles in it. And in industrial areas, you can have as much as 1,500 particles per this. So there's plenty of particles up there. And also, when water forms, it can form on the surface of the water because water likes to bring it together. And so this happens. And as long as it's over the warm water, it keeps sucking up more and more energy, releasing that energy as it's condensing. And so then it starts to move on its own. You know, it gets so much wind, then because of the earth turning, causes it to spin, the Coriolis effect causes the thing to spin, and we get a hurricane. Now, the hurricanes build up as long as they're over warm water. Hurricane Katrina was a Category 1 storm over the Atlantic, but it went into the Gulf of Mexico, and it was 85 degrees temperature. So there's a lot of energy there to get that storm going to a Category 5. When a hurricane goes over land, we've cut off the energy supply and the hurricane dies down. If it goes over cooler water, there's less water vapor in the atmosphere, loses its energy. That's why typically when they come up here, they weaken compared to when they're down. Except some of the hurricanes that have come very quickly, 1938 hurricane, 1954 hurricane, raced up the coast and they didn't have time to really dissipate their energy and caused major disasters in our area. Now, an interesting thing is, okay, so what happens here when water freezes? What happens to that energy? It dissipates into the atmosphere. So when we freeze something, it gives off heat. Kind of seems strange, but And people sometime in greenhouses will actually, if it's going to be a freeze, put pans of water out so that it'll freeze and give off a little bit of heat to keep it from happening. If you think of down in Florida, the citrus crops, when there's a chance of a freeze, they spray a mist over the plants. So as that mist freezes, it gives off heat and keeps the plant from totally freezing hard. And so also, once something freezes, we have insulation on it. That's why around here, what do? To the cranberry box? You flood them to get the things, but you leave them so that they freeze over the winter. The freezing protects the plant from the cold, dry air that's out there. And now, what if water didn't freeze the way it does? Because if water freezes, the ice forms at the surface. What if it didn't freeze that way? What would the effects on life be? It would freeze from the bottom up. So you'd have a new way of doing ice fishing. You know, you could just go around and pick up the fish because you wait till they come up to the surface. Okay, so this is the way the hurricanes form. You get the converging winds in that interconvergent zone at the equator where the winds are coming together, and they're coming together and then they rise up. You get high pressure up the top, and so these winds form the bands of thunderstorms. But the temperature is generally over 80 degrees in the areas where thunderstorms are formed. Another thing, that interesting thing about water is that it has a high specific heat capacity. This means that water can absorb a lot of energy without its temperature changing. If we look at aluminum takes about 0.22 calories per gram to change, say, a mass of aluminum 1 degree. Water takes 1 gram. So it takes just about five times more energy to change the temperature of water 1 degree than it does to change aluminum 1 degree. So if you think of when you're cooking and boiling water, the pan is very hot, but you could probably stick your hand still in the water and it takes a while for the water to heat up because water absorbs that. Now, so what does that do for us as far as if for us living near the coast? That water during the summertime is absorbing all that heat, and the temperature isn't rising enough. Whereas inland, the ground heats up very quickly. So you get inland, you have more temperatures over 100 degrees or so, whereas close to the coast, you know, if we're lucky, for the most part, if you get into the 90s and stuff, because what happens is, you ever hear of the weathermen talk about a sea breeze? Well, what happens is the land warms up. And when the land warms up, it draws the air into it. It like creates a vacuum, and it pulls the air off the water. And so it brings the cooler air into shore. And it's usually around in the afternoon, because typically around 3 o'clock is the hottest time of the day. So you get most of that rise, and it brings the stuff in, and that's what cools us. Well, on the other hand, and in the wintertime, that water has absorbed all that heat during the summer. So now it starts to give off that heat. And when it gives off that heat, it keeps the coast warmer than inland, because the inland area may get hot, but it also gets colder very quickly. So it gives up the heat. So that's why you see inland, it gets very cold, whereas near the coast, we stay mild. And that's, again, due to the water and due to the chemistry of water. Compressibility. For all practical purposes, water is not compressible. But it actually does compress a little bit. It's like 0.00000000004%. But the water, the oceans, because they're so deep and so massive with the amount of water, they'd be 100 feet higher if it wasn't for the compressibility of water. But just think, for all practical purposes, it's incompressible. So how does that help us as living beings? That water can't be compressed. Okay, you can put a boat in there. How about in our bodies?
You're not going to suddenly dissipate
What happens when your heart pumps? What if water compressed when your heart pumped? No effect. So because it can't, it allows water to be moved through our bodies, this characteristic of water. Now, also water is known as the universal solvent because it can dissolve many things. And this is what a cube of salt, well, let me put it here. Oh, going back to the technology. See, all the water's gone, it's all on this point. Okay, we look at, here's a cube of salt, sodium chloride, which is an ionic compound, meaning that they're held together with the electrical charges that are formed in a transfer of electrons rather than a sharing of electrons. So how does water dissolve things? And because many things in the Earth's crust are partially ionic, the most abundant minerals in the Earth's crust are the silicates. And silicates are partially ionic, partially covalent. Some of them, like salt, are 100% ionic. The more ionic something is, the more it dissolves. And so how does that happen? Well, if I look at, remember the water molecules have a positive end and a negative end. So the positive ends of the water molecule will go towards the negative chloride. And I'm just going to put this down a minute. And if you have your little, if you look at this, see how the molecules are all going around the positive end of the molecule is going around the molecule of the ion, the chloride ion, and so it negates the charge on the ion and it pulls it off. Now you have the negative end of the water molecules going towards the positive ion, and it negates the positive charge on there, and the material starts to move, the ions move within the water solution because of, again, the polar covalent nature of the water molecule. So eventually all your salt dissolves in there. Now, what happens when you take the water away? The salt comes back because now, stuck to the cold there. Now you have this, the ionic bonds take over here and you get the formation of the salt crystal once again. So many things are dissolved by water. So that's why many materials can be transported within the body, because they're dissolved by this, and also in the ground. Just think, when water hits the ground, it dissolves a lot of the minerals that are in there. So when plants take up that water, that the minerals move with it into the plant, and we get that. So again, this characteristic of water with that, those hydrogen bonds. Okay, now we see some of the characteristics of water, but water is never still. Water on the planet is always moving. And so if we think of it, this is the hydrologic cycle, which explains how the water molecules move. And it's driven by the sun. The sun, even though it's 93 million miles away, the energy that it imparts to the Earth is enough to, remember, needed 540 calories per gram of water to evaporate. So the water doesn't have to boil to evaporate. All it does is have to have the water molecules enough energy so that one can break away from the other, because you notice, you know, puddles on the ground disappear. They're not boiling away. You know, they just disappear slowly because the molecules are gaining enough energy. And that's in the process where called evaporation, the part of the... We also have the water that I talked about leaving from the trees in the form of transpiration. So water is taken up by the soil but released into the atmosphere. That's why plants are so important for flood control, because they can take up, big trees can take up hundreds of gallons of water and throw it into the atmosphere rather than it running over the surface. So trees play in it. Vegetation plays an important part in transpiration. We also have, sometimes you have sublimation, which is where you'll see snow and it just turns into a gas. Certain very, you know, special characteristic conditions required for sublimation to take place. Okay, now, then we have condensation occurring. And remember, we can get condensation condensation occurring, and we have clouds without rain, because when you have a cloud, you're in like fog. You know, that's what a cloud is like. You have all the little water aerosol droplets that are moving around. What happens is, remember, the water likes to combine with itself. So when there's enough moisture up there, they combine with themselves, and then the clouds get darker. The reason we see the clouds dark is not because the clouds are dark, because if you ever fly in a plane, you go by a thunderstorm, it's beautiful white clouds. But when we're underneath, all that moisture is blocking the sunlight. So that's why it's the clouds are dark. And so then we get precipitation if enough of those particles come together to make the droplet heavy enough so that the air currents can't hold it up, then they come down. So if you think of all, you know, it takes about a million little droplets of water in the atmosphere to make one drop. So you can imagine how much is up there. And so when water comes down onto the ground, here, if it falls on a surface where it can't penetrate into the ground, then we get surface runoff. And it runs off and goes into ponds and all and lakes and makes its way to rivers back into the ocean. Now, if the water falls on areas where it can penetrate into the ground, that's called infiltration. The water makes its way down into the ground, into what's known as groundwater. And groundwater, if we think of, move my little camera here, and then the groundwater makes its way back to the ocean. This is, when we think of groundwater, we don't, it's not like a river flowing under the water that you're sticking a straw into with a well. It's dirt, and the water is flowing through the dirt. And this is a groundwater simulator that we have here. And so we can see that there's a lake right here, and here's a stream over here. And so we have wells. And so I'm going to actually put some dye into this, and we can see there's actually water flowing through this. So as you notice that it's moving, but it moves very slowly. In the ground, if groundwater moves 3 feet in a day, that's a lot of movement for groundwater compared to looking at surface water when it's running. We can see it moving like this. Now, there are different types of aquifers. An aquifer is a geologic formation which has two main characteristics. It has spaces between the rocks so that it can hold water, but it also is permeable, meaning water can flow through it. Because if it's not permeable, it can never be recharged. So once you suck the water out of it, that's it. So it's not an aquifer. So we can see that the water's moving in there, and there, this is called an this thing right here is called an aquitard, meaning that it can't, the water can't penetrate through. So you can see the water's moving, the dye is moving along that level. And when we talk about the water table, in a unconfined aquifer, it's almost like a bathtub. The more water I fill into there, the level is going to rise. If I take the water away, it's going to go down. So that's the, but in a confined aquifer, it's always full, but the water is under pressure. And so we'll see that, you know, you can have different areas. This is another aquifer that's between those two layers. And we can even have of bedrock can even have aquifer in it. And bedrock is solid rock like granite. You can have an aquifer in there. A big place for aquifers is volcanic rock. Because just think when volcanic, it cools, what happens? It cracks. And you have a lot of spaces in here. So this well is going into a, you can see the water will move more quickly through that. Now, one of the things, if you look at this well right here. The dye has come through, and the dye is rising up into that well. That's called a flowing artesian well. And some wells can be 500 feet deep or more, and water can just gush out of them without any pump or anything, because where it started from, where the water was first going into the ground was high up in the mountains. And so as the water comes down, it's under pressure. And you know, if you have a tube of water, water tries to equalize itself from one end to the other. Well, water tries to equalize itself here. So if I stuck a straw in there, this is under pressure, the water's gonna rise up. But it doesn't rise up all the way, because a lot of the energy is dissipated because that water is moving through the rocks and it gives up its energy as it moves through. So we can have, this is a aquifer with a water table, an unconfined aquifer, and then this is a confined aquifer, which is confined between two layers. So this is where we get our water from, and we have, this is surface water, and then we have our confined, our aquifers. And basically in the United States, about half of our water comes from groundwater and about half comes from surface water. More of the major municipal plants and everything are surface water, but we have a lot of small things that are wells and things like that are coming. So we get about half and half. And this is a Fall River. And if we look at what our water is in Fall River, we get our water supply. This is the North Watapa Pond, and this is the Copacut Reservoir. This reservoir was set up in the 1960s, and it was the Copacut River was dammed. They put a dam right over here, and this builds up. Now, the way that water gets brought into this river is there's no pipeline connecting them. Water is pumped from this into this swamp, the King Philip Swamp, and it just makes its way by gravity over to the pond here. And so this is fills in our water supply. And so how do we get our clean water? Because there are many ways that water gets contaminated. There's physical contamination, there's chemical contamination, there's radiological contamination from uranium mining and things like that can cause, and the biological. And you talk about diseases. So this is the water plant in the city of Fall River. And this is where the water intake is right here. and there's raw intake wells that draw the water flows into this, and then the wells pump it into the system. Chemicals are added into the water to make a flock. And this flock is a aluminum hydroxide flock, which is kind of sticky and also has the charges on it allow materials to stick to it. So as it's moving through, and you have a flock tank, so you have a slow stirring, the stuff's moving around, it's picking up all the fine particles, the colloids, which are very tiny particles which don't settle out, but they're picked up by this material. And then once you have this material, after a while, a certain amount of time through the water that it picks it up, it goes into settling tanks. So that now that material is heavy enough so it can settle out with time. Then from the settling tanks, it goes into sand filters. And the sand filters polish the water to remove any of the other material that's left behind after sedimentation. And then after that, there's some form of disinfecting because there's still organisms that are present in the water. And so a lot of them were removed by that process, but there's still some that are there. So we add the chlorine is the most used material for disinfection. It's cheap, it's easy to use, and it's effective. Chlorine gas, these are chlorine gas tanks, they're fairly dangerous. So because any chlorine leak can kill people. You know, it kills bacteria and stuff and disease causing all that, it can also kill people if it's around. So you have to be careful with chlorine gas. So a lot of places have switched to hypochlorite, which is bleach. You know, just like when you buy household bleach and everything, they're using that for disinfection. It's easy to handle, it's safer, and it's not as effective, you know, so you have to use more of it than with the chlorine gas, but it's still, the benefits of the safety outweighs the thing. So, and then from there, we pump it into the water tanks so that now they're high up, so we create that pressure, just like with the confined aquifers where the water was being recharged up in the mountains. We put things in our towers so we get that high pressure. And actually when Charles Dickens came to America to see our water process in Philadelphia, and he was amazed at how on a third floor he could get pressure on his things, because there was nothing like that in Europe at the time. And so we get our water. Now, after we use our water, then our water goes to a wastewater treatment plant because we can't just discharge our water because we have our diseases, potential diseases in there. That's the main thing of why a wastewater treatment plant is there, to prevent disease spread into there. But we also have other solids and everything. So this is the Fall River Wastewater Treatment Plant where I worked for 11 and a half years. And the water comes in over here, and the water actually first comes in and it's distributed. It goes through a screening process to remove big solids. Then it goes to a aeration tank where the grit, it's actually a grit removal, but it's aerated. So you remove the sand and everything, because sand will kill pumps if sand goes anywhere beyond that. And so then from here it goes into settling tanks. These are called the primary settling tanks. And so the heavier solids are settled out. Then from there, the effluent from these are pumped along right over here through this pump to the secondary part of the plant. And in the late 70s, secondary treatment became the requirement, and it's actually a biological treatment. So when we talk about biotechnology, in wastewater treatment plants, we're raising millions of gallons of bacteria to do work for us. And it actually breaks down the organic material that's present in the water, and it's removed here, and these are the aeration tanks. Then from the aeration tank, we go into the secondary clarifiers, and in these clarifiers, the bacteria are settled out. And so we don't get rid of the bacteria then. The bacteria pump back over here, because when they're over in here, they're using up their food, and they're hungry again. So we send them back into there, and it gets cycled like this. The effluent comes out, and then comes down here. This is a chlorine contact tank, and it's made in this serpentine shape to make sure that it's in contact with the chlorine for a certain amount of time to make sure that disinfection takes place. Now, bacteria are reproducing, so we oftentimes get extra bacteria. And so we have to get rid of that, so it goes into thickeners to get it more concentrated, then it goes into this building where it's pressed and we squeeze more of the water out of it, and then we get a cake. And the cake had been in the past burnt in an incinerator here, but now the cake is actually being put to landfills, and some people are just taking the liquid sludge and using it for different things. If you don't have a lot of industrial waste in, you can actually make fertilizer out of it. And that's what they actually do in Boston. The solids from Boston are turned into fertilizer, but they also use, they have anaerobic digesters in Boston, which they capture the methane gas from the breakdown of it, and they use it to power the plant. So that with some of the ancient technologies. And so some of the things we hear about, again, with the thing, we have about 1.2 million miles of water pipeline. We have about 155,000 public water systems in the United States. That's systems, individual water systems. And then we have about 700,000 to 800,000 miles of public sewer pipeline. So we have about 2 million miles of pipeline under us. So anywhere you're walking, you're probably walking on a pipe somewhere. And there's about 14,000 public wastewater treatment plants. And so about every, you know, these pipelines are over 100 years old, some places 200 years old, and haven't been repaired since then. So a pipeline suffers a break every 6 years, every mile of pipeline. And 1 out of 7 gallons of drinking water is lost to leaks. So that's a big thing that they're assessing the situation where they're actually making sure we're not losing that water. Because just think, 1 out of 7 gallons you paid to create, you're throwing it out somewhere. It's leaking out of the pipe. And so sometimes they're big leaks, like you see there's water spraying all over the place. Just Quincy just had a huge break. Or sometimes they're small leaks that are underground. But they can actually, with sound and all, you can hear the leaks. So you can go around and detect the leaks. And so we'll have to spend about $1 trillion in the next 25 years just to maintain our systems, for our water systems. And it's important because, remember, we all need water. We can live without gas, we can live without oil, we can live without coal. We can't live more than a couple of days. We can live without food for a long period of time, but we can't live without water for more than a couple of days. And so if we think of that, how much do we spend on water? The average family spends about 1% of its income on water. You spend more on your cable TV, you spend more on these other things, and no one seems to complain when you raise the cost. But if you raise the taxes to get for your water, raise the taxes, we can't do that. We can't raise taxes for water when it's the one thing that you need. You don't need any of the other stuff. But, you know, so one of the things that we don't hear about is the people. Normally we see about the pipes and things like that, but we usually don't hear about the people involved in water treatment. And so there's currently about 117,000 people in the water, wastewater, and so we're expected about a 6% increase in growth in the next 10 years because of the increased demands of water. And then they'll also have to replace about 33,000 workers, because people are retiring. The age of retirement is very high, particularly in New England. New England is going to be hit harder than a lot of the other areas, because the average age in New England is almost about 50 for people working in the water and wastewater field. And so about 25 to 50% of the wastewater workers are going to retire in the next 5 years. So there's a big push. So one of the things we created here at the college through a presidential fellowship, I created the Blue Center for Water Technologies here at the college. And it's over at E107. You know, if we look at that, this is the area, this is our lab area. You know, this is the equipment that we had from that we put together for it, for treatment of training of water and wastewater technicians. And in spring of 2016, I was awarded the $602,000 NSF grant in order to expand our water treatment programs. And also, we're working with community colleges throughout New England in order to create the curriculum. And we had people from all over New England come to create the curriculum. And now we're putting the courses together, and then it'll be spread throughout other community colleges throughout New England. So that, because it's not only New England-wide, the problem with water and wastewater workers, it's nationwide. California has about 4,500 open positions in the water and wastewater field that they can't fill. And our students get the jobs pretty quickly, and one of them up there just got his job, and he hasn't finished the program yet, and he's working in the water plant. And so that's one of the things we have. Oftentimes they get the jobs and then they're struggling to finish there. Yeah. So part of this program is to create a curriculum and we have the NEWT. This stands for New England Water Treatment Training. And I have the NEWT is water newts are amphibians, and they're usually a sign of good quality water when they're available. So having well trained operators will also provide good quality water. So we have the NEWT, and they get the little hard hat on there. So what we're planning to do with this is to create the curriculum where we brought the people come, and then one of the things is also by having the hybrid courses, people who are in the field that want to expand themselves don't have to spend as much time out of class. They'll come in because the hands-on is important. And we're getting more equipment and everything for hands-on training with pumps and working with pumps and things. I'm building, one of the things I've got going right now is, where did it go? The picture go. Right there, is getting our aquaculture system going again. And I've modified this, putting in a clarifier that looks, so this is our, for wastewater treatment training. So I've got about 30 fish in there right now. We've got the goldfish. I just put them in because I just got it started just to make sure that they're not dying. And I just rather before I put the regular tilapia that are going to go in there. And then from here, the water flows into a clarifier that separate any solid waste. Then it goes into a biofilter here. Then it goes into a rotating biological contact or another biological treatment process, and from there it goes into a ultraviolet disinfection system, and then it comes back into the water. So students will be able to actually study all aspects of wastewater treatment right through there, doing the actual mathematics of measuring detention time and everything using that. I'm also building a water treatment plant in 107 that will have all the components of a regular, and you'll actually have a little control panel that you can turn pumps on, turn pumps off, adjust the speed of the pumps, the dials and everything, and so you have a little panel that you'll be working at and see everything right in front of you as all the treatment up there. So that's part of this, and plus we'll be doing outreach to high schools and everything to get people coming, because that's one of the things, getting people into the field and getting them interested. You know, you're coming out, you're paying, earning about $20 an hour to start. I have a student that's going to be doing an internship, and he's getting paid $20 an hour over the summer. And then he'll do his internship and figure for about 4 weeks, and then they can hire him full time. And he'll get a raise when he gets hired and stuff. So, you know, there's a lot of positions in both water and wastewater right now. And so if anybody, general studies people, you know, people looking for things to go, where to go and where to send them, this is where an area, because it's not going to be outsourced. You know, it's full-time employment. That's why a lot of people, the average experience of someone leaving in New England is 24 years. So there's going to be also a big brain drain when they leave.
Yeah.
And so that's why it's important to have the operators that are well-trained into there. And we'll also, we're working with prior learning assessment, so that if you have already have the certifications and your licenses. Like I have a grade 7 wastewater license, grade 3, so if people already have those licenses, they can get credit for the courses that are to prepare them for the TIF. And so that'll help them to move through the system easier. And then also there's a lot of non-credit training around. So you'll get credit for portions. The courses are gonna be designed in modules. And so you can move the things around and so you can get credit for this portion of the course. So then you don't have to, you know, probably come for that portion of the course and stuff. And so it's gonna be, people are looking forward to it. We have people working throughout New England on this. I was the first person to use the Blackboard Collaborate for actually a New England-wide meeting. And it worked out pretty well, you know, so because you can see everybody, can see each other, and you know, we could put up whatever things we wanted to show and things like that. So it worked good for the winter. In the summer times, well, people like to get together and stuff like that. But in the winter time, particularly in New England, you don't want to be driving around the snow and everything. And I have someone from Northern Maine, which I'm going to see next. I'm going there next week for a meeting, right at the Canadian border, at the tip of Maine. Presque Isle, Maine, so a 7-hour ride up there. So I'm going there on Tuesday and come back on Wednesday. And so it's gonna be an interesting thing. And so I'll stop there, and I don't wanna keep you longer, but if anybody has any questions, if you still have time, if anybody has any questions. I hope you learned a little bit about water, how we treat water, and some of the things that we're doing here at the college.
I leave, when you mentioned when the hurricane originated, I just thought Cape Verde.
Yes.
Thank you for the
And actually, one of the things also with climate change is a big thing affecting our water supply and certain areas that are deserts are expanding. Jose up there is from Africa, and his community is putting up trees to hold back the Sahara Desert because it's expanding, and actually some communities have been covered over with sand already because of that. And other areas are getting more water.
This is a prime example of why community colleges is so important. I mean, you don't, at 8 years old, you don't say, I'm going into wastewater, you know? And then you start to learn a whole lot, when you did, but you start to learn a whole lot of things about what water is and the properties of water and the importance of water. And you can see, like, there's a reason for all of this, and that the skills are available to you at a place like the community college.
And it's interesting to say that, because my first public presentation on the environment was given in 1970, and I still have the paper. It was in my seventh grade class, and it was on water pollution. And I put the whole process of how water treatment plants work with a public presentation. I did the whole process of how wastewater treatment plants work. I had about how pollutants move through the ecosystems and everything, and it's interesting.
Makes sense.
1970, when I was 13 years old.
Makes sense.
This is why it's important to be interested in science, because there's more out there than you realize. There's more available to you.
Yeah. And again, at community colleges, we can ship things a lot faster than some of the other areas going.
I surmise that this is being videotaped and that hopefully it will be available to many of the persons who are not here, and especially the students.
Does the water in the tank refilter?
It keeps, this is a like an aquarium filter right here, so the water's being drawn up, it's going through here and it's going down through here, and it's moving through here. So it's interesting with this thing. There's actually a underground storage tank right here. So you can imitate a leak of an underground storage tank. There's a septic tank right here.
No,
so you can imitate how septic tanks work. And then with this thing, I can do any of the advanced hydrologic equations that can be studied just like
know, you were growing in the field. Anyway, and we do a lab where we go through a lot of this. You can look at the hydraulic gradient so you know which way the flows are going. You can actually measure, you know, the amount of volume of water flowing through an aquifer and everything. So it's, and one thing we also have as part of this grant, which we started in our first NSF grant that I was working on, a principal investigator of the Southeastern Massachusetts Achievement and Retention and Technology Grant, which started about 2006, after 3 years. We created the lending lab. And our lending lab, we have the equipment that we have at the college is available for high schools to use when we are not using it. So that, and we have a website, and on the website it has the different equipment, it has lesson plans that you can use with the equipment. And so we're going to expand that now to the community college. So community colleges in other parts of New England, we're putting together a package. I wanted to actually give, as part of the grant, give each community college about a $15,000 grant that they could use to whatever they needed. Because some will have certain things, some have another. But even the NSF told me, you can't be providing grants under your grant. If they want their own grant, they have to apply for it. But they did allow me to put together a package so that people can borrow it. So they can take the equipment and use it till they get their own equipment. Okay. Then it comes back, then it goes to another. They allow you to make two of these packages together. So it's a good thing that we're doing. It's moving. I have was able to hire a lab technician to work with me, and I have a student doing his internship with me right now and helping me set up the stuff. So I'll cut up right now, so let you go. I gotta get to the next city council meeting.
Thank you again.
Thank you. But Father, you just mentioned that. If anybody who's here doesn't realize, there is a Fall River City Council meeting being held in the faculty staff lounge today. And that is the Health and Environment Working Group of the City Council.